We just covered the basics of computer hardware and its different components, but let's get into a little bit more detail. Computer architecture refers to how the hardware components of a computer are put together. So, like we mentioned last time, the most important components of hardware are the CPU, or the central processing unit, and the main memory, or RAM. These two components make up the core of the computer. All other devices are called peripherals, like our secondary storage, so the hard drive, and I/O devices like a keyboard and a monitor. We can't interact directly with our CPU and memory, so we need these peripheral devices. Controllers are devices that coordinate the activities of our peripherals. Each device has its own way of formatting and sending data, so each controller's job is to handle these so that the CPU doesn't have to worry about it. So for our hard drive, we'd have a disk controller. For our monitor, we'd have a video controller, and so on. If we had other peripheral devices, they'd have controllers too. Okay, great. So we have all of our components laid out, with the CPU and RAM making up the core, and the secondary storage and I/O devices making up the peripherals, with controllers acting in between. But how are they actually connected? Information travels between our components across a group of wires called a bus. So that'd look like this, with a wire connecting our CPU and RAM, a wire connecting our core to our controllers, and wires connecting the controllers to the peripherals. Let's take a closer look at our CPU. The CPU interacts with main memory to perform all the processing in our computer, basically doing all the work. The CPU interprets and executes instructions one after another in a continuous cycle. This cycle consists of three parts. The control unit coordinates the processing steps and coordinates the transfer of data and instructions between main memory and the registers in the CPU. The registers provide a small amount of storage space in the CPU itself, so they're basically built-in memory cells that hold operands, memory addresses, and intermediate results. Some registers have special purposes, like the instructions register holds the current instruction being executed, while the program counter holds the address of the next instruction that will be executed. Finally, there's the arithmetic, or logic, unit that performs calculations and makes decisions. So that's how the CPU works internally, but what about when it's interacting with the main memory? Well, there's what's called a fetch-decode-execute cycle that explains this. Basically, an instruction is fetched from the main memory based on where the program counter says it's located, and then it's put into the instructions register. The program counter is incremented to prepare for the next cycle, and then the instruction is decoded to figure out what operation needs to happen. The control unit then carries out the instruction, whether it's loading a data value onto the register or performing a computation. The instruction set is very important here because it includes the instructions for loading CPU registers from memory and for storing their values back into memory and for all the operations. It's also important to note that a computer system's main circuit board contains a system clock, which basically just generates an electronic pulse at regular intervals, much like a clock ticking, but a lot faster. For example, the clock speed, or rate at which the pulses occur, for an Intel Core i7 processor can be 2.9 GHz, which means 2.9 billion pulses per second. The speed of the system clock is synced up with the CPU, meaning that the system clock tells us how fast the CPU executes instructions. The computer's overall performance is based on the CPU's speed, which is in turn based on the frequency of the system clock, so a faster system clock means a faster CPU, which means better performance. So that's how our CPU works. Next, we'll take a look at how the other part of our computer core works, the memory.